Good morning to all. It's a good day. The Lord has blessed us richly. It's a day of memorials, of memories, of celebrating God and country. We've got 4th of July, big holiday tomorrow. I hope all are going to enjoy the freedoms and the liberties that we have, but enjoy food and fellowship with friends and family. Neighbors, it's a good day to celebrate. But not to get too far away from why we're here. Listen to a couple of messages last night for information. And one verse that came out that just I knew it all along, but it was just so refreshing to hear again. It comes out of Romans chapter 1. Verses 17 through 18. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation from his wrath and punishment to everyone who believes in Christ our Savior, to the Jews first and also to the Greek. For in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed, both springing from faith and leading to faith. It is written, and forever remains written, the just and the upright shall live by faith. Before we start our song, hymn service, let's pray. Hallelujah, we celebrate, O Lord, that you are our God, the creator of all things, the provider of all things. We give thanks, Lord, that you love us. We give thanks, O Lord, that you call us your children, and that in that we find great comfort. You've blessed us richly with your love, your grace, your mercy. You have sent forth your Holy Spirit to guide us and to comfort us. Help us as your children, O Lord, to ever strive to do your will. Help us, O Lord, to serve. Help us to not just be restricted into these four walls, but to know that our mission is out the door. Help us, O Lord, to do what you want us to do. Guide us, direct us, take our hand, Lord, and fill our cup. Our prayer to Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, Christ our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Won't you stand with me for our opening hymn?
It's true, it's our dream. to God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Welcome to worship this morning on this beautiful, beautiful day. We come together today to celebrate not just our freedom in this country, but as every day we celebrate our freedom and independence through Jesus Christ. Let's look at a few announcements before we go into prayer time and offering. We will restart our aftershock next week, so that will restart next Sunday evening if you want to take part in that. Our breakfast will not be here tomorrow morning, taking the holiday off, so our people can celebrate, rest, and rejuvenate for next week. Wednesday night, we will be here for Bible study, so from 6 to 7:30, we're here with dinner and child care. Change for change into the crayons for the Church of Christ food pantry. And then our VBS Day t-shirts have been ordered, banners ordered. We're about to have our registration put up live. We'll do registration online this year, kind of like we did through JAM at the school, so parents will be able to do it online through a QRL. We'll also have some iPads set up the night we start, so parents can come in and do walk-ins for any of that. Any other announcements that I'm missing this morning? Anything I'm forgetting? All right, let's pray over our offering and over our issues this morning. Lord God, we thank you so much that we do have freedom in this country, that we celebrate independence, Lord God, from all things. We celebrate, God, our freedom not just as Americans, but we celebrate our freedom as Christians that came at such a heavy price. And so, God, we thank you that you did not require us to pay that price, but instead you sent your own beloved Son to pay that price for us. And so we thank you, Lord God, for the soldiers that fought for us in this country, and God, for your Son that laid down his life for us. And so, God, we pray for this country. We pray that your peace would rain down. We pray that, Lord God, your name would be shed among all others and bring hope and light to a world that is facing such darkness and such anger. We pray, God, that it would be your peace that passes all understanding in all situations. God, we pray for our community, that you would continue to be lifted up as God of this city, not just in this church, but in all of the churches that we gather together with arm in arm to storm the gates. Lord God, we pray for those churches and that you would strengthen them as well. We pray for our congregation, both here in person and those that join with us online. We pray that, God, you would fill every single need as it comes upon your name today. God, we also pray for this offering that would come in. We thank you for the ways you have blessed this church and every single ministry you've called us to, you have provided. And so, God, we thank you for that. We pray that you would continue to lead and guide and that we would be open to listen. So, Lord God, bless these gifts, these offerings, and bless the givers, Lord God, that give with a cheerful heart over and beyond. We thank you for all of this. And we join together to pray the prayer that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the glory, and the power forever, and all God's people said, amen. Boone and Brooklyn are not here today to pass the plate, so you're welcome to put it in as you leave or in the box in the back as we gather together.
Thank you.
Cohen. That was performed by John Wayne back in about 1966, 68. It was written by, of all people, Robert Mitchell. I think if I remember right, Robert Mitchell was a Western star also, yeah. And he wrote this wonderful little poem that John Wayne, in his magnificent voice, recited. Now, if you want to, won't you be seated? The title of this poem, Why I Love Her. America, America, God shed his grace on thee. You ask me why I love her? Well, give me time, and I'll explain. Have you seen a Kansas sunset or an Arizona rain? Have you drifted on a bayou down Louisiana way? Have you watched a cold fog drift over San Francisco Bay? Have you heard a bob white calling in the Carolina pines, or heard the billow of a diesel in the Appalachian mines? Does the call of Niagara thrill you when you hear her rolling waters? Do you look in with awe and wonder at the Massachusetts shore, where men who braved a hard new world first stepped on Plymouth Rock? Do you think of them when you were strolling along a New York City dock? Have you seen a snowflake drifting in the Rockies, way up high? Have you seen the sun come blazing down on a bright Nevada sky? Do you hail the Columbia as she rushes to the sea, or bow your head at Gettysburg and our struggles to be free? Have you seen the mighty Tetons? Have you watched an eagle soar? Have you seen the Mississippi roll along Missouri's shore? Have you felt a chill at Michigan when a winter's day her waters rage upon the shore in thunderous reply? Does the word aloha make you warm? Do you stare in disbelief when you see the surf come roaring by the reef? From Alaska's cold to the Everglades, from the Rio Grande to Maine, my heart cries out, my pulse runs fast at the might of her domain. You ask me, why do I love her? I have a million reasons why. My beautiful America, beneath God's wide, wide sky, and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. If it's convenient, won't you stand with me? America the beautiful.
Oh, beautiful, forsaken, just die.
continue. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Again, you ready?
Yes.
You're fine. Excuse me, I didn't plan ahead, didn't bring everything up. Special music comes from an old hymnal that I borrowed years ago. And it's a song called Our God, He is Alive. It's written by a fellow by the name of A.W. Dykus. Now hold on. He was born in Festus, Missouri. I didn't look it up, but I kind of chuckled at the name Festus. He was born somewhere around 1888. Died just not too long ago. 1979. Started out kind of poor, but he set his jaw and he went and got him a bachelor's degree and then a master's degree, and then he got a PhD in physics. And he is noted for having invented numerous little gadgetries, but one of the most famous that is not used too much anymore is the turn signal on your car. he also invented an electric pencil sharpener. And there's some more fun things that he did. But he turned his life to preaching. Now, he was a Church of Christ preacher and enjoyed sharing the word. Well, where this song came from years ago, about 160, 70, 80 years ago, there was an atheist by the name of Nitzler, a German. He first came up with the idea of God's dead. And that carried on for a long while. And then sometime not long ago, in 1960-ish, there was a young fella teaching at Emory University in Georgia. His name was J.J. Olitzer. And he said that God's dead, and that it's just kind of a waste of your time to be dealing with this idea of God. Well, back to A.W. Dykus. That kind of set his jaw a little bit, and he sat down. Oh, in his older age, he wasn't quite as active. He sat down and wrote music, and both the words and the music that goes to it. And he penned this song, Our God, He is Alive. But you know, history keeps repeating itself. And I've heard rumbles that there's some folks that are saying the Bible is not God's inspired word. They're also saying something like, Jesus is more of a historic figure, and there's more than one way to get to heaven. And there's some other troubling things that are brewing on the horizon. And I know that my God is alive.
Amen.
Thanks for that, Jeff. There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tinted its skies with heavenly hue and framed the world with His great might. There is a God, He is alive. In Him we live and we survive. From dust our God created man. He is our God, the great I Am. Our God, who sat upon a tree, a life was dwelling there to give, that He from sin might set man free, and evermore with Him could live. There is a God, He is alive, in Him we live.
first century church and how we all dare to be the church we're called to be. The Apostle Paul wrote this: they had learned to be content in any circumstance, that he was rejoicing always, that he was anxious about nothing. So you might say in this, well, he didn't go through a year like we went through in 2020, right? But it might be helpful to know that he wrote these words from a Roman prison cell, awaiting potential execution under the Emperor Nero. So what is it that Paul knew that allowed him to write these words in those circumstances? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. So if you have your Bible, we're going to be in Acts chapter 5. Now, in my experience, one of the most stressful things as a Christian in growth is hard. Growth is hard. Growth produces stress. Growth produces anxiety because growth brings change. So it produces this stress both internally and externally, right? Externally, you can put a target on your chest because people are going to throw stones. They just always have. As Christians, we see that in this first century church. And internally, because we keep changing and adjusting as we mature in our faith, there's internal challenges that come. Things that we realize we have to walk away from. We have to make different. We have to be different, right? So this is what we see throughout this book of Acts as the church continues to expand and grow. There's these external issues and there's these internal issues. And so once again, here in chapter 5, the church is thriving and it creates this external issue. So if we're going to begin with verse 12. At the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were taking place among the people, and they were all together in Solomon's portico. But none of the rest dared to associate with them. However, the people held them in high esteem. And increasingly, believers in the Lord, large numbers of men and women were being added to their number to such an extent that they even carried the sick out into the streets and laid them on cots and pallets, so that when Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on any of them. The people from the cities in the vicinity of Jerusalem were coming together as well, bringing people who were sick or tormented with unclean spirits, and they were all being healed. We're going to stop right there and let's pray. Gracious and holy God, as we step into this message verse by verse, we read your words, gracious God, your holy, breathed, inspired word. God, we would ask that as you spoke to this first century church, that you would speak to us today, that you would dare us to be your people, that you would dare us to be your church, and that you would lay out the groundwork and the path through this message. So God, move me aside, open our ears, our hearts, and our minds to hear from you today. We ask all this in Christ's name, and all God's people said,
amen.
So it's worth noting right here that the signs and wonders were limited to the apostles. There's nowhere in the book of Acts where it says that all people were going around performing these signs and these wonders. The apostles were a unique group of men called to a very specific time in history. So they continued to do these signs and these wonders. And verse 13 tells us that none of the rest of them dared to associate. And no one's quite sure who the rest are. It's kind of impossible to figure out. But what's the point is that it's clear that there's now this significant tension building up between the religious council and between the religious and the civil council and between the civil council and the apostles. So people are feeling the danger and they're pulling back from them because right now it's pretty risky to be seen with these apostles. We're also told, though, in verse 14 that more and more are believing. So the first number we're given in Acts was 2,000, and then we're given 5,000, and so that's the last number we're given here in Acts. But it says that they continued to build, they continued to grow in their number of believers, that there were multitudes, not just multitudes, but multitudes constantly being added to their numbers. So the church was absolutely exploding in Jerusalem in this scripture right here. So this is the first time we've learned, though, that it's moving beyond Jerusalem, that it's moving beyond people being healed, that it's moving beyond just the simple spreading the good news. We're learning that as Peter walks by this shadow, that no one knows, this shadow that's following him, that is actually healing people. And they're bringing people out into the streets on their cots. They're bringing their friends. They're bringing their sick ones. They're bringing their tormented ones. And these people are being healed because there's this healing power flowing through these apostles, specifically through Peter. But of course, that's going to extract external pressure. Let's look at verse 17. I'm tongue-tied today. But the high priest stood up, along with all his associates, and they were filled with jealousy. They laid hands on the apostles and put them in a public prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the gates of the prison, and leading them out, he said, "Go stand and speak to the people in the temple area the whole message of this life." So the family, the high priest, they were all Sadducees. The majority of the council were all Sadducees. They were much more the social, much more the political sect versus the Pharisees, who were much more conservative and religious. And they're quite jealous now, we hear, of this movement taking place. And so they arrest him, they put him in jail, but in the middle of the night, this angel comes and breaks the doors, busts them out, right? This angel of the Lord comes and busts them out. Now I'm thinking Luke has to be writing this. Remember that Luke is the author of Acts. I'm thinking he has to be writing this particular story with a smile on his face, right? Because one of the distinctives of the Sadducees is they don't believe in angels and they don't believe in demons. And so ironically, here comes God in this bit of irony, sending an angel to bust them out of jail. I think that's so funny. So the angel doesn't say, "Go, run for the hills, don't come back, go, save yourself." No, the angel says, "Go, stand and teach." Now, in this situation, the word stand is a military term, meaning stand your ground, stand firm, and keep doing what you're doing. Hold the line. So basically, when the sun comes up, they are right back in the middle of the temple courtyard. They're teaching, they're preaching, and the Sadducees call in the Pharisees, right? And the full council meets, and they come together, and they're going to have the apostles brought before them, right? And so they're going to rough them up a little bit. They're going to tell them to shut up, and they're going to send them back on their way. But word comes back. Word comes back, and they don't know exactly how to explain this, but the jail is completely locked. The guards are all standing in place, but the jail's empty. It says they were perplexed. That Greek word actually means like at their wits' end. So they had no idea what was going to happen next. They had no idea. Had these men run for the hills? Had they disappeared? Would they ever see them again? They could not imagine what they were about to hear. But notice the way that the scripture words. It says, "The men whom you put in prison are standing," there's the angel's words, "they're standing in the temple and teaching the people." So this is the next morning. They're right back where they were, and they're teaching again. So they go back, they get them again, they bring them back to the council. And it's interesting that Luke tells us that the officers were concerned for their own safety. They were concerned at what was going on. These people now favored the apostles. And so they were concerned that at any moment, if these apostles had just raised their hand and given the word, a riot would have broken out. So they are terrified now of what would happen. But the people respect authority, and the apostles respect authority, and so they went with them, right? So an interesting question to me might be, why were they released? Why would they be released in the middle of the night only to be out there preaching the word, preaching in the temple, bringing the message as the angel told them to bring? Why would God bust them out of jail to put them right there in the morning to have them picked right back up and brought right back out? I think the message is not anytime you're in jail, God's going to get you out. Basically, anytime you're in a prison, God's going to get you out. I think the message might be that no matter where you are, God's going to be there. Sometimes God's going to break you out of that prison where you are to free you. Sometimes God's going to come to you in that prison, right? Exactly like he did Peter. What these guys realized were that they were blessed, that they were called up in the name of Christ. They were blessed to be brought up in the cause for Christ, right? They knew they were going to be beat up. They knew they were going to be in prison. Most of these apostles, except for probably John, were crucified, were executed in different ways because of the cause of Christ. I think the message that we have to learn in this is you can't stop this. You can't stop it. God wanted these apostles and the fellow believers to know, if I want you out of jail, I'm going to get you out of jail. If I don't want you out of jail, if I need you to sit right where you are, then that's what I'm going to do. And that's what happened. That's what happened when the Apostle Paul sat in a Roman prison for 2 years. 2 years, and he finally comes to the conclusion as we read in the scripture that in all circumstances, I'm going to rejoice. In all circumstances, I'm going to trust God. I think it shows us that in all of our circumstances, we have to trust God too.
Yes.
Sometimes God will pull us out of a prison and send us on our way to do exactly what he's calling us to do. And sometimes he'll heal us inside the prison, because that's where we're going to learn to trust him. That's where we're going to learn to turn everything over, right? Now, one of the interesting things to me as we go on in verse, let's go ahead and read. Now, when the high priest and his associates came, they called the council together. That is, all the sons of Israel, sent orders to the prison for them to be brought. But the officers who came did not find them in the prison. And when they returned and reported, saying, "We found the prison locked quite securely, and the guards standing at the doors. But when we opened them, we found no one inside." Now, when the captain of the temple guards and the chief priests heard these words, they were greatly perplexed about them as to what came of this. But someone came and reported to them, "The men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple area teaching the gospel." Then the captain went along with the officers and proceeded to bring them back without violence, for they were afraid of the people that they not be stoned. Go ahead and go forward. When they had brought them, they had them stand before the council. The high priest interrogated them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to continue teaching in this name, and yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and intend to bring this man's blood upon us." Now, this is the interesting thing, that they say this man. They won't even say the name of Jesus. They won't even say the name. Just, "We gave you strict orders not to continue teaching in this name." Now, Jewish law required for the common people that there was a warning before they would be persecuted, before they would be beaten, before they would be punished. And so basically they're telling them, "We told you not to do this, and you continue to do this, and we're giving you this warning. Now something is going to happen." But what they say here is, "We gave you orders not to continue teaching in this name." So they've gone out, they've told everybody what happened. They've told everybody that this is the man, this is the Messiah. And so basically they're telling them, stop using his name. Stop telling people we did this, right? This is a whole other turn from what happened just a few months ago. You think back to this man standing in front of this council. He's standing in front of this council, and this council and Pilate were back and forth, right? Pilate really didn't want to execute this man, but there's this political maneuvering going on, and so finally Pilate says, "I tell you what, that's fine, y'all can have him. Let the blood of this man be on you and your children." All this political maneuvering going on, and just a couple of months later, they're here saying, "Hey, don't blame us, we didn't do it. Stop using his name, stop telling people we did this." But Peter doesn't back down. Go forward, look at verse 29. But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our Father raised Jesus up, whom you put to death by hanging him on a cross. He is the one whom God exalted to his right hand as a prince and a savior to bring repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." I think in verse 30, when he says God raised him up, I don't think he's necessarily talking about the resurrection here. I think looking at commentaries, he's talking about that God raised him up as the Messiah. They're letting him know. They say he's the Savior. They call him the Prince. The Prince means Lord. It's Master. It's everything, right? And so they're letting him know he's the Prince. He's the originator. That's the Greek word for Prince, originator. He's the originator of the gospel. They're letting him know, this is that man. This is that man. You can't even say his name, right? And what Peter says to him next is pretty powerful, pretty remarkable. He says, "And we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." He talks about a great repentance and forgiveness of sins. He's letting them know, we know what you've done, but if you repent of those sins and turn to God, he will forgive you. Go forward. But when they heard this, they became infuriated and nearly decided to execute them. They were furious. "How dare you suggest we have sinned," right? That's kind of common in this world, you know, nowadays, isn't it? It's kind of common in this world that people are surprised when you tell them they've done something. be, as y'all know. You could go out, you could be friends with your neighbors, because you had neighbors you talked to, right? You had a community of people in your community. Your kids might ride down the street. If they did something wrong, your neighbor's going to get on to them. And the first thing you said to your kids was not, what did that neighbor say to you? It was, what did you say to that neighbor, right? If the teacher called you about your kids, the first thing you asked your kids was, what did you do? Not, what did that teacher do to you, baby, right? That's just how the world used to be. People were held accountable. And as a world, we had these boundaries that we stepped into. And what's happened little by little by little over time, as we, as people, have conformed to the world, when somebody kind of steps outside that boundary, we don't say, in Christian love, okay, can you let me pull you back in this boundary line, okay, so you'll be in line with God. No, we say, let's widen the boundary. And what's happened in the world is now the boundaries have gotten so large, there's no boundaries, right? That's what's happened in the world. You go back to Genesis 3, and you recall the lie of the serpent. He said, you can be God, and you can decide what's right and wrong. That was the lie of the serpent, right? But when someone comes along and suggests that someone is a sinner like they do right here, boy, people get upset. How dare you say that? How dare you say that they're wrong, right? Y'all, here's the deal. This is the most important deal of all. God has never moved his boundaries. God has never moved his boundaries, and he won't. And when we step out of those boundaries, we fall prey to sin. We fall prey to being separated from God, who longs to forgive us, who longs to offer grace, who longs to offer mercy. But we have to be willing to admit we're sinners. But the council doesn't want to do that, and they are furious, and they intend to kill all 12 apostles. Look at verse 34. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, respected by all the people, stood up in the council and gave orders to put the men outside for a short time. And he said to them, men of Israel, be careful lest of what you're about to do with these men. For some time ago, Judas appeared, claiming to be somebody, and a group of about 400 men joined him. But he was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After this man, Judas of Galilee appeared in the days of the census and drew away some people after him. He also perished, and all those who followed him were scattered. And so in the present case, I say to you, stay away from these men and leave them alone. For if the source of this plan or movement is men, it will be overthrown. But if the source is God, you will not be able to overthrow them, or else you may even be found fighting against God. I don't think he's speaking philosophically here. I think he understands there's about to be a bloodbath. I think he understands and is trying to stop it. I think he's arguing what would, in a way that would make sense to the Sadducees, right? I think he's reminding them. I think he's telling them that what's about to happen, you don't want to be a part of. Because no, not just are you going to destroy these men, but if it is truly a movement from God, God will destroy you. I think that's what he's telling them here. And I think he's reminding them, and it reminds us every day, if something is of men, well, then it will fail, and that should be our prayer. If there's ever a ministry in the church we start, we always pray. When we obey that ministry of prayer, we'll say, if this is of you, God, let it flourish. And if it's not, slam the doors and let it fail. Because that's the only way to start a ministry. If it's not of God, then it shouldn't flourish, right? Think about that in the church. I think there are many churches in this town that are wonderful, wonderful churches. We are not the only church in this town. And we join together with them every time we can to shed the light in the dark world. But there are churches in this world that, as Sid said, don't believe some of the fundamentals of the faith. That they don't believe in the authority of Scripture. And they don't believe in substitutionary atonement, which means Jesus died for us. We couldn't have done it ourselves, so there's this substitutionary atonement. They don't believe in the deity or the lordship of Christ. Some of them don't believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Those are the fundamentals of the faith. That's what churches that believe these fundamentals gather together and become the church. Right? Verse 40. They followed his advice. And after calling the apostles in, they flogged them and ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus, and then released them. So they went on their way from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name. Now, it was not usual that people died in the process of flogging. Y'all, it doesn't say that the council followed his advice when he says leave these men alone. It doesn't say that they followed his advice and left him alone. It says they followed his advice after calling the apostles in. They flogged them and ordered them not to speak. And in the name to not to speak in the name of Jesus. And then they released him. Flogging was typically 39 lashes, typically 13 on the chest and 26 on the back. They would have been a bloody mess. Not near death, but a bloody mess. But it says they went on their way from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer shame for his name. The next verse tells the entire story of Acts. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not stop teaching and preaching the good news of Jesus as the Christ.
Amen.
Every day they did not stop. All different translations, I looked it up for different words, did not stop. They did not cease. They wouldn't quit. All different translations. But these 12 apostles, they received this flogging, these punishments. They received threats. They're put in jail. They're taken out of jail. They're put back in jail. They're taken out of jail. They did not stop. That tells me you can't stop this. You can't stop the work of God. You just can't. If it is from God, you can't stop it. And what Paul knew is he sat in that Roman prison cell and wrote, I can rejoice in all circumstances, was he knew that no matter what, in the end, Jesus wins. The church triumphs. And he knew that. He was content that the future was glorious and everything was going to be okay. No matter what, he was content and rejoicing because he knew that he had given his life to something that mattered.
Yes.
Something that would last thousands of years, right? No material possession will last all our years. No material possession lasts forever. Not your house, not your business, not your car. No material possession will last a thousand years. But the church will last forever. And we knew that. We know that, and they knew this, and that's where we learn it. Can you imagine looking at something that you've given your all to, and at the end of your life watching it just slowly fade away? That it didn't last forever? Now imagine being one of these apostles and rejoicing as a bloody mess because you've been beaten for the cause of Christ. And rejoicing. That's what it means to give your life to something of awe. The church knew that it was going to survive. They knew that in the end, Jesus would win because they'd walked with him, they'd seen him, they'd served with him. They'd been there. There are churches all over that have worried how they're going to keep their doors open. There are churches all over that have worried how they're going to continue being in ministry. And I had somebody last week after we did our camp kids and we did our little slideshow and I asked for volunteers for different things. And they said, you know, preacher, you're always trying to talk us into serving. You're always trying to talk us into giving just a little extra hour here and there. And they laughed when they said it. And they volunteered at something. But I said, I want to tell you something. It's not that at all. The last 2 years, we haven't struggled. We haven't. We've struggled to get people to come back here. We've struggled at different things, but we haven't struggled to be the church. Amen. We just haven't. Here's why. We have this amazing army of people that show up every week. Whether you're here for worship or we have a group of prayer warriors that come every week and drive around this church 10 times and pray for it. Every single week, 10 times around this church to pray for it. We have an amazing army of people that come and set up for worship. We have an amazing army of people that lead worship. We have all these people that come and do amazing things. Not because y'all are amazing, I'm not patting your back, because God is amazing.
Amen.
And because these people have answered what God has called us to. to Brew Crew, to Confirmation, to Youth, to Wednesday Night Bible Study, to Celebrating Friendship, to Jam, to VBS, to Puppet Ministry, to all these different things. God has done amazing things because we have amazing people that want to serve. We're not desperate. That's not what it is at all. We just want to be in ministry with God. And when you're in ministry with God and you're serving, you're not doing yourself a favor. You're doing the kingdom a favor.
Yes.
That's what we're doing. We give our lives to things that matter. Because we know what Paul knew. That in the end, God wins. In the end, the church triumphs. That's why we dare to be the church. God is calling us to be the hands that pull people from their prison cells and break those chains and show them the way to Jesus Christ. Or God is calling us to sit in the prisons with people until they learn to trust Him. That's what we're called to do when we dare to be the church.
Yes.
Let's pray. Gracious and holy God, we celebrate that you have called us to be a part of something that will matter forever. This is kingdom business, gracious God. And we answer the call, whatever it may be, great or small. Nobody in this room wants to waste their time or their life, Lord God. So call us to the things that matter. And may we hear clearly about what ultimately matters in the end. Lord, may we be your church. May we never fight against you, but stand firm and walk with you in everything you call us to. May we dare to be the church. We ask all this in your Son's holy and redeeming name. And all God's people say,
amen.
Our closing hymn, America.